Welcome, my name is Rohit Lotlikar. I am a faculty at Sophie International School of Engineering, and today I am here to talk about the challenges we all face in data science projects is not having enough raw material, right? And I am sure many of you have experienced this. Over the last I think 10 odd years, you know, we always see this graph of data growing exponentially. People talk about, you know, every year the data is growing some 30%, right? It may even be growing on your system or your hard drive. But when you come to the data science, the project that you want to do, when you want to deliver insights to the business, you always have this problem. I don't have the relevant data. So am I just getting unlucky? Or is my luck, am I not understanding the problem that other people are, you know, saying that there's too much data, right? So of course, the problem I think we all understand is data is growing very fast, but the relevant data, the data that you need for your project, that's not growing so fast, right? That is often missing. You might even have a large number of observations, but you don't have the attributes that you need. And I'm sure many of you have experienced this. So let me talk about, you know, what is it that we can do, right? How can we overcome some of these challenges? And I think the growth of data science, you know, to come in the future years is really going to be dependent on, you know, not, you know, better algorithms, but also on acquiring data, right? So I'm going to do a case study, talk about some of the experiences. This is from a few years back at one of my previous organizations, where we were doing, this was actually with IBM, where I was previously employed. And, IBM is a large company. It has different types of businesses. One of IBM's main business was the contact center business, the business process outsourcing business. And what is this business responsible for? One of the things they did was to run contact center operations. Contact center operations for clients. One of the clients was a bank in Australia, a large global bank. And IBM was running the contact center operations for this bank. They were doing it out of Philippines. Now, you know, this was there was specifically a team responsible for credit card operations. So the bank's credit card customers, they would call into this contact center whenever they needed some help. And so these guys were here in Philippines helping these customers. Now, after servicing, you know, a customer would call in for whatever thing they had to call in about, and then these agents would service those, you know, customers. Now, you guys, I'm sure most of you get calls from banks, right? And you might probably have a bank relationship manager, and that bank relationship manager keeps periodically calling you and tries to sound helpful. Sir or madam, I can help you with whatever your need is. Do they really mean that? Do they really want to help you? No, you are the prey. They're trying to sell you something, right? And that's why they're calling you. And their job was exactly that, right? The real job was to sell products. So of course, initially they would service the customer and whatever the customer needed. But after that, they would try and pitch some of the bank's products. Typical bank, it had, these were credit card customers, and this bank had other products. Savings account, checking account, insurance, mortgages, additional cards, the usual portfolio. So their job was to sell, you know, maybe an additional couple of products. Now the question we were asking ourselves, so I was part of IBM, and I was part of IBM research, and the contact center part of IBM came to me and said, hey, Dr. Data Science, can you help us do something fancy and help improve our sales? And so I said, okay, let me have a look. Let me see how data science can help. So I flew over down to Philippines and went to the contact center operations and tried to look at what these agents are doing there. All right. So the way these agents would work is, they had a CRM tool where they would see the customer's information. So whenever a customer called in, the customer's profile would show up in the CRM tool. And then these agents would look at their profile and try to get some sense of, the customer. you know, is this a family person, is it a single person, what is the income, you know, bracket, what is the age bracket, these kind of things. Get a general sense of the customer. And then they engage into a conversation with the customer. Hey, sir, glad to help you. I see you're, you know, been using your card regularly. Do you find our reward program attractive? You know, try to get into a conversation, and then, you know, in that process, try and sell, you know, something else. So that was what they used to do. The question was, we thought, you know, maybe we could build a propensity model. Right? That's the first obvious thing that comes to mind. In the CRM system, we saw these agents are seeing, you know, these 6 to 8 products that each customer they can pitch, and they have to select first product and then maybe a second product to pitch to the customer. There's no obvious, you know, thing in the tool that is giving them some idea what to pitch. They are themselves doing their assessment of what the customer might need through that conversation, and then trying to find some product that they think they can tempt the customer to buy. So propensity model was the obvious thing. So we had a conference call with a bank in Australia, and you know, we proposed, hey, we can build a propensity model and rank the products and give that ranking as a guidance for the, you know, agent to sell. So that would appear in the CRM, that ranking. Well, what did the bank tell us? Well, they told us they already have a propensity model. Okay, but we don't, where does it show up for the agents? How are the agents, don't seem to be looking at any output from the propensity model. They said, well, in the CRM system, the products that show up, they are ranked according to the propensity. They're ranked according to the propensity. But these agents were completely ignoring it. Well, they didn't really care, right? I mean, they had their own way of doing things. I don't care, you know, we're going to do it our way. As long as we meet the targets for selling these products, well, you know, we're done our job, right? And that's, and we told the bank, hey, these guys are not really using the propensity model. They said, fine, as long as they're using the, you know, meeting the targets, the sales team doesn't care. Why should the decision support team in the bank care? Right? So, well, so that was the situation. All right, so we had to really come up with a plan B. They already have a propensity model. Can we build a better propensity model? It's not clear that we can. The guys in the bank have a decent team. They're the domain experts. They've been doing it for a while. Why should we as outsiders, an IT company, come in and be able to build a better model than the bank's internal team? Maybe we could, but even if it's a little bit better, it doesn't mean that the agents will use it. It has to be substantially better for the agents to notice a real difference. So we needed a plan B, and the question was, you know, we had to come up with a plan B, right? And here is, we are already, whatever data is there that the bank is already leveraging. So our plan B has to be based on something else. What can that be? All right. So, you know, I said, let me understand, you know, how they're trying to sell. So this is what they do, right? We listened in on the calls, right? So me and another colleague of mine. And what did we learn? 3 things. This is what good agents did. First, they would look at the customer profile. They would try to categorize this customer. Hey, this looks like a family guy. He looks like good income. Maybe he can be pitched some insurance, or he can be pitched some, you know, additional card for a family member. Then they would strike up a conversation, you know, a gentle, gradual flow, not to make like this really selling to the customer, but, you know, trying to solve a customer's aspiration, right? Customers have aspirations, trying to understand those aspirations, trying to position a product to meet those aspirations, right? So they're getting clues to that conversation. What does the customer really need? What are their aspirations? And then they match those aspirations to one of the bank's products, something that they can tempt the customer to buy. So does data science have a role here? Does it have a role in the sales process beyond a propensity model, which already was there? That's a question we have to answer. So this is what we did. The question is there, what can be improved, right? If you're going to pitch something new, you're going to first look at what is the issue, what is the problem? Is there a problem in the first place? What can be improved? The first thing was the variability in the sales. Now, sales, anywhere you go, right, sales is not easy, especially in a contact center. In a contact center, you have a high level of churn. These are kind of people who are just out of college, 1 year, 2 year out of college, or maybe not even college, maybe just done high school. And you know, here they're facing a customer. From day one, they're not at all productive. It takes months for them to become productive. And that's because they have to understand what the customers are like. And they have to understand what are these, you know, the typical customer of the bank, what are their, you know, kind of aspirations, what are their needs. And then they get a sense of that. They get a sense of different segments of customers. And they have to figure out, okay, for this segment of customer, this is the kind of product, you know, that they're interested in. So this takes time. It takes months, right? So there's a long learning curve. And then there's a huge, huge churn. Again, contact center agents, right? If they're not leaving the company, they're moving into a different account, a different client within the company, right, to learn something different. So this is a problem in all contact centers. It's a problem in sales in general. And you know, how can data science help here is the question, right? So this was the first problem, right? The variability. There were good agents. I would say the top 25% were the good ones who were mature. Then you had the middle two quartiles, and then you have the bottom quartile, right? So the idea was, can we make the lower quartile pull them up, right, using data science? The second thing, right, these agents were getting into a conversation, but were these questions really enough personalized? Or could it be made better? Can the questions be more targeted and personalized to extract more valuable information? What do we mean by that, right? Let's take an example. Here's one of the questions that these agents would ask the customer. We see you're, you know, using the credit card a lot, and you have, you know, paying interest every month. Do you find the interest rate attractive? This is one of the questions they ask. Sometimes they would ask this question even if a customer has just, you know, they see in the CRM system, last month the customer paid interest. They might ask this question. But in the previous 12 months, the customer has not paid interest. They've been paying the balances in full every month. This is just because the customer ended up paying late that 1 month because of some oversight. Maybe not the best question to ask this customer, because they're not the kind of person who really has, you know, doesn't have the money to pay off the credit card. But that is something, it's very difficult for these agents to do, because in the CRM system, all they see is the recent data, the last month's statement. If they really have to go back and look at the pattern for the last few months, they generally don't have time for that, because only when the call comes in, that's when they actually, the CRM data pops up. So there's no way for the agent to really profile the customer. What they're seeing is a very high level, rough idea of the customer's profile they're getting. So what data science can do is actually analyze the customer's profile over a longer time period, not just that most recent data, and come up with a better profile of the customer. Come up with better questions that the agent could ask the customer. And that's what we thought we can do. So what is it that, you know, instead of agent coming up with questions, what if we built a tool that could guide these agents, what questions to ask the customer? Think about it. Machine learning is not giving answers. Machine learning is coming up with questions, questions that will be valuable in understanding the customer better. And then, step two, based on the response of the customer to those questions, can it come up with an improved propensity score? Can it refine the propensity score that the bank already had just based on the response to those questions? And that is a much better propensity score. It's trying what the bank's propensity model with what these agents were trying to do. Trying to learn the behavior of the good agents, trying to learn the best practices of the good agents, making it available to all, even the most recently joined agents. So coming up with the questions and suggesting a product fit. Those are the two things. In fact, there are three problems, right? The first thing is coming up with a customer propensity based on all the historical data of the customer's credit card spending over the last year, 2 years, based on the demographics. Coming up with questions to ask. Now we are saying here two questions, coming up with two questions. Why just two questions? Just two questions because this is a, you know, you don't want to feel the customer like, you know, you're running a survey to them. You know, so sometimes I get these surveys which are really long and you think, you know, you there may be four or five questions. Sometimes if you click on that survey, you get in the email, you think maybe I like this company, maybe I'll help them and give them some feedback. And that's great, you click on that survey. Sometimes the surveys are short, right? Sometimes they'll run into several pages. And at that point, you just abandon it. So it's important to just ask two questions, maximum two. And then based on the customer's responses, based on the response to the question, can we update the propensity score? So we're solving three problems here. Not asking questions is not a traditional machine learning problem, right? Coming up with the right questions to ask. It's kind of a missing data problem, but it's not received a whole lot of attention, especially in live interactive scenarios like a contact center. So these two questions, the second and third problem, were really important to differentiating what the bank was already doing and what we as IBM, you know, what we could bring to the customer. The criteria was now, how do we pick those two questions? What is it important? What is the criteria for picking questions? Now, you know, these questions are not, we have a question bank. We came up with a question bank of 15 questions by talking to subject matter experts, product experts of the bank's products. So we had these 15 questions. The question was which two questions from this to pick. And so we had to come up with a criteria, right? This is the problem formulation part. What is the criteria for picking questions? It is, you know, which are the questions, you know, you already have a propensity score from the bank's historical data. Now the criteria has to be which questions are the most useful in helping discriminate between the products. Your bank's propensity score might have given, say, similar scores, you know, two products might have very similar scores. Which question will help, you know, discriminate the propensity more further? So that was the criteria. So what we essentially wanted to do was to model what we were calling the utility of a question. Each question, we said, it has a certain utility. We have to find out that utility and ask the question with the maximum utility first, and then the next question. So the model was like this. Essentially, we took a systems approach. What I mean is, systems approach is, you know, don't combine everything. Break up your problem into pieces. First piece was, you have the propensity score from the old data, which is all the existing old data. Then that old propensity score is getting refined based on the responses to the questions. So based on what the customer answers, you have an increment to that propensity score. This increment could be, it could increase the propensity score or it could decrease the propensity score. Here I'm talking about some product, right? For that product, the propensity, depending on the customer's response, the propensity could go higher, it could go lower, or maybe it will stay around the same. So add these two, you get the final propensity score. So which question to pick is really which question has the most contribution in the second box here. And essentially, how much is the customer's propensity spreading out? You have a certain propensity, initial propensity, base propensity based on the historical data, based on the customer's response. How much could be the spread in that propensity? That spread is the utility of the question. If the customer has, let's say a question has two answers, yes or no. Typically these questions are yes, no kind of questions. And let's say when the customer answered yes, the propensity increased by 5%. If the customer answered no, then the propensity increased by 4%. So there's a 1% spread. That's not a good question. It's hardly making a difference. Whether the customer answers yes or no, hardly the propensity is going to change. A good question is when there is a large difference between when the customer answers yes versus when the customer answers no. So that was our utility metric. Now we have some challenges here. The challenges were, we had a cold start problem. We are starting this fresh. We don't have any historical data on, when I talk about historical data, I'm talking about the responses to the questions. We don't have any of that because we are starting this fresh. So we have a cold start problem. Data is growing very slowly. We did a pilot with a limited number of agents. don't expect the data to grow very fast. This is not like a web scale problem where, you know, you have tens of thousands of customers on your website. Very sparse data. Each customer is asked only 2 questions, 2 out of 15. So it's a very sparse matrix. So these are the challenges. The cold start problem was, you know, we did it through business rules. We said, okay, based on some business rules, we will come up with the initial questions to ask the customer. And then based as you know, the responses get collected, we will refine, we will be able to compute the utility of a question. And that utility of the question will then be used, you know, to refine, you know, which question gets selected. So let's talk about, you know, how we actually compute the utility. Let's say we have one question. One of the questions is one of the actual questions. Do you hold any other credit cards? Now, remember this, these kind of questions are important. You know, in a credit card customers, you know, in the bank's data, the bank has no idea whether you have other credit cards or not. All they see is that, you know, you have their credit card, right? So they have no idea whether you hold other credit cards. So let's say you have a product, insurance product, which you are trying to cross sell, and then you have this question. We found that this question, the response to this question affects the probability that a customer will buy insurance. Why do you think it might happen? This was our model. When the customer, let's say, you know, in the initial thing, you have, this question is asked to a certain number of customers. Among those customers, about 10% of them, 10% of them are accepting the product, insurance product. So the propensity, the base propensity before the question is asked is 0.1 or 10%. Then the question is asked to the customer. Now, depending on the customer's answer, sometimes it's yes, sometimes it's no. People who answered no to this question, 25% of them ended up accepting the card, sorry, the insurance product. Customers who answered yes, they have another card, only 4% of them ended up accepting the insurance product. So you see that how this question is helping? Based on the response to the question, we get a better sense of whether the customer will accept which product. In fact, this question, while it is being, was in this example, it is for this insurance product, it affects the propensity of other products as well. So this really helps you, you know, re-rank the products. Some products you might see going up in the ranking, other products coming down in the ranking. It's not just insurance that gets affected. So this is our model. Now obviously, the other thing is matters if, let's say, if 95% of the customers said yes and only 5% of the customers said no, even though this, you know, spread just 0.15 and 0.06, the spread is large, on a weighted basis, the spread is still small. So we really look at it on a weighted basis. So we weight it by, you know, how many people say yes and how many people say no. So based on that, we come up with a utility for each question. So that we call the weighted spread is basically gives us the utility of the of this question. And this is just for the insurance product. We do the same thing for all the products. And this gives us the utility for the question. So we get a utility for all questions as we start, you know, the cold start problem is there, of course, but once we have, you know, start collecting the data and, you know, asking questions and collecting responses, and we get this, we start updating the utilities. And over time, the utilities start settling down into some, you know, their long-term values. This is what the interface looked like. Let me explain this. So we, here we have a customer. You have some profile data of the customer. Some of the, those, these are, what you see here are the different products, initials for different products like insurance, additional card, and so on. These are the products. So, you know, when the customer calls in, the questions pop up, right? Initially, the first question pops up. The first question here is your current payment method convenient? Now, this question is actually used for, you know, to understand whether the customer might be interested in taking a, you know, a current account or a savings account. If the current payment method is not convenient, you know, then they might be more likely to go for a bank's savings or checking account, right? So that was the idea. Then based on the response to this question, another question pops up. This is about maybe know if you have another credit card. So that was the second question that popped up. Because the customer answered yes here. Maybe if the customer answered no here, maybe something else would have come up here. So you have these questions and you have these questions popping up. These questions are based on the customer's profile. So firstly, they're personalized and they're selected to be the ones that are most discriminating for this kind of a profile. And then each time the customer answers the question, this is where you have the ranked list of products. The top one is AC, which is a checking account. Then the second one is credit line increase. So each time the customer answers a question here, the ranking will change here. So what happens in this way is that as the questions keep getting answered, the agents, they can actually see this ranking changing. They see the ranking changing, and they're interpreting that. They're interpreting that a customer who answered, who doesn't have credit cards, maybe they're, more likely to take up insurance. So they're also learning. They're learning to connect customer profiles with the product fit internally in their mind. They're building a mental model of that. And this is improving, making the learning curve shorter. So what are the outcomes? We did an A-B test. Over 6 weeks, we did a pilot with a test group who was using this tool and a control group. The test and control groups are balanced in the sense that because there's a lot of variability between the agents, we make sure that we have different tiers of agents in terms of the performance. We make sure that the test and control groups have the same balance in terms of agent performance. So this is what we found. Over the 6 week pilot, we got about a 15 to 18% increase in sales in the test group, which was using this tool. Interesting thing was the improvement in sales was maximum for agents who are new. Experienced agents who are good, for them the increment was less, which is what one would expect. Other thing that was important is customer experience. Is customer experience, the bank was concerned is, will my customer experience be, degrade? This kind of probing might seem a bit structured and artificial. Will my customer experience degrade? Thankfully, hardly any customer declined to answer questions. We had kind of come up with the scripts in a way that it could be smoothly inserted into the conversation flow. Hardly any customer declined to answer questions. So essentially, there was no customer, experience impact. Agent experience, right? The novice agents, the ones who are new within the first 2 or 3 months, they're the ones who find this the most helpful. It helps them reduce their learning curve, and it helps them improve their performance. So they were very happy to use this tool. So given these outcomes, where can we use this? Is it just for sales? Is it just for a bank's customer center? In fact, any kind of a sales process you have, you can apply something like this. You structure the sales process in a way, sales conversation in a way that it can be more formalized. And once you have these kind of a formalized this conversation, you can use this tool to sort of encode, what your really good salespersons are doing, encode their practices, encode their best practices. That is what that knowledge is being encoded in this tool. IT support, that's the other big area. In IT support, what do you have? All of us, we have this issue. We go to an IT team, and sometimes the people we encounter are really good, they fix your problem. Other times, they're struggling to fix the problem. Of course, then many of them are new people. But what if, these IT support tools, whether, Remedy and ServiceNow and all these, they have a lot of, fields where once a problem is fixed, the IT support person can say what they did to fix it. What was the root cause? What was the diagnosis? What did they do to fix it? Often that is not populated. So it needs to use something like this. You don't need to build a new tool. You can use the data in that old tool, but you may need to have these IT people put in the right kind of information into that tool. What did they really do? Sometimes they'll have something like, I talked to David, he told me what to do and I fixed it. And that's useless, right? So a discipline has to come in. Once the discipline comes in, you have this valuable data that you can use. customer service, huge long service, right? And why can't the, you know, I think Amex, I don't know, are there people from Amex here, American Express, right? Yeah, okay. I get very big long service from you guys. And all sorts of irrelevant questions. So you can really personalize your service, make it shorter. You don't have to ask every question to everybody, right? So do away with those surveys. And what else? Healthcare. Healthcare systems, right? So we have now, you know, more people are getting into using decision support tools in healthcare, advising doctors on, you know, based on the results of the test, what might be the symptom, you know, what might be, you know, ultimately be the issue and what might be the remedy. But sometimes, you know, one of the issues is still is like the low confidence, right? And the low confidence is because there's so much variation. I respond differently to you or you, right? Each person responds very differently. And sometimes more tests are needed. Telling doctors not just what the diagnosis is, may or might be, but if the confidence is low, telling them which other tests should be done to improve the diagnosis. So these are some of the applications. Obviously, any application like maybe IoT something, right? If you have an IoT devices or cameras, those kind of things, this may not be the right one. Because those things, there's no cost, additional cost. Once you have installed the camera or once you have installed a sensor, there's no additional cost to collect more data. Cost is only installing a new sensor. So that might not be the ideal case to use this. But anytime where you have a human interaction, those kind of things, this is very, very useful to minimize the amount of time that people have to spend giving you information. What's holding us back, right? Why aren't we seeing more of this happening? I think there are two reasons, right? One is something called an availability bias. What is an availability bias? You might have heard this. It's a tendency to focus overweight data that is available and neglect data that you don't have. This cartoon is saying that somebody in today's newspaper, yesterday there was an airline crash, and then, you know, like that, whatever, MH370, or you have one of these Boeing planes going down, and then you're scared to fly for the next several weeks, right? You're overweighting the immediate data at the expense of other data. That is an availability bias. The same thing happens in data science. You know, all of us data scientists, we get, you know, trained on whatever data source, like Kaggle or, you know, other data sources. There you're given the data on a platter. In the real world, it's not like that. You have to go and look for the data. So we don't really get trained in terms of trying to identify what data, extra data, we really need to solve the problem. And that is a gap in training of many data scientists. The second thing, in any organization, changing an existing process, trying to change a tool, is not easy. There'll be a lot of resistance to that. People are used to doing things in a certain way, and this introduces uncertainty that people don't like. So what can you do here? For the bank, what did we do? I didn't talk about what we did for the bank. The bank wouldn't let us touch their CRM system. No way, right? So what did we do? We built a parallel tool. We built a parallel tool where the agents were using to see the questions, a web-based tool. All they had to do was log in through the browser, and then it would show them the questions. They would answer the questions there. At the back end, the two things were connected. It was just a one-way feed. They don't want us to push data into their CRM either. So it was a one-way feed where the data was coming from their CRM system. So yeah, so sometimes parallel tools are needed, at least in the pilot phase. And hopefully at that time, the organization gets convinced at the end of the pilot that they can do something more permanent. So I would really encourage people to try and change, not just think of data science as, you know, working with the data you have, but also trying to figure out what other data you need. Because that is responsible, you know, for the growth in data science. Otherwise, data science is going to, you know, at some point, the algorithms that we have, what has been driving the improvements in deep learning? It is data. Larger and larger data sets, speech data sets, ImageNet. It is a growth in those data sets that's really driving better algorithms. It applies even if you have structured data, business data. In fact, asking questions is really a sign of intelligence. This is a book I bought some time back. Nice book, If you have kids, you might want to read it. Asking questions is a sign of intelligence. In fact, a lot of our professionals, doctors, lawyers, detectives, the main work they do is asking questions. That is really key to diagnosis, really key to finding out who's the culprit. Machines should ask more questions. In fact, I'm going to close with this remark, right, by Yoshio Bengio. We need to really think of, you know, he's kind of a little bit negative view on deep learning, but I want to focus on this part of the message, right, where AI needs to be extended to be able to acquire information. We can't just keep, you know, focusing on the algorithms, you know, getting better results on ImageNet. We have to go and help algorithms also acquire information from the ecosystem. So this, with that, I think that was my last slide. And I think am I on time, more or less? 10 minutes? 10 minutes, yeah. So we can have, 10 minutes, good. So we can have a few questions now. Yeah. Yeah. Right. Oh, so the conversation is happening on the phone. The kind of questions we came up with were mostly the multiple choice questions. Yes, no, or like what, like one of the questions was what do you find more attractive? The reward program or the interest rates or the interest free days. So it's like typically multiple choice questions. So the agent, when the, by the agent. Oh, the questions, yeah, the questions were, the question bank was created by experts, subject matter experts.
Adding to that question, like I have also built one of the model in one of the largest private sector bank, and where I need to recommend the customers regarding the same thing. It was a call center and we have to recommend about the product. So we tried like their past history and then exploratory data analysis and combination of that we were predicting that different product. So here also it was kind of exploratory data analysis that you used because questions response is yes or no, based on that it is happening. This I wanted to know.
No, we didn't do any exploratory analysis for the questions. Questions were, I mean, the sense we spoke to the agents, we weren't looking at data. It was conversations. We spoke to the agents, we spoke to the bank's product experts and came up with the questions that we thought would be the most useful. No, there was no speech to text. The agent was listening, entering it into the drop down list.
How did you come up with the top two questions for each customer?
How did we come up with
top two questions?
I explained that tree kind of a thing where I explained. You remember that tree kind of a diagram? So. So let's say there are two responses, possible responses, yes or no, right? If the customer answers yes, there is some probability. If the customer answers no, there is some probability, right? If that spread between the yes probability and the no probability is large, so we say that the utility of the question is high. And that utility, the question with the highest utility is the first question to be asked.
Okay, but you need to ask the question first, right?
Huh?
See, out of 15 questions,
yeah,
you'll be asking only two questions in each customer call, correct?
Yes.
So once you ask, then he gives yes or no answer, then only you can find the difference or impact the propensity score.
Yes.
So at the first time,
How
do you know which two questions to ask?
Good. So I said, you know, I said we have that cold start problem, right? That is what the cold start problem is. To start with, you don't have any data. In that case, we had business rules. The first week, it was kind of actually a tuning phase, the first 2 weeks actually. The pilot was, I said, 6 weeks, right? But actually, it was 8 weeks, where the first 2 weeks was just a tuning phase, where the questions were just based on business rules, and we collected some data. And then the six-week pilot really started.
Hello.
Yeah.
I have a question. So, like, just to have a, like, see, we are having a set of questions for, like, the, is it really the machine learning algorithms are required to predict, like, the which kind of question to be asked to the customer, or it can be done? It can be done just with the EDA.
When you say machine learning, the point is you don't need a sophisticated model. In fact, here we had a very simple model. It's just a discriminant analysis.
Okay, and the second question is like, as you have proposed, like the this last slide, ki like algorithm itself should acquire the information. It means acquiring the data. Right. So, do we have any kind of the research paper in that, like the any other algorithm which is successful in acquiring the data, or have we any progress towards it? Because this is the new kind of things which I am hearing it.
Yeah. So there is actually there has been work in the past, but it hasn't received a lot of attention. There's something called active learning, which is about not acquiring features, but acquiring which observations to collect. That is one area, active learning. The other area is feature value acquisition itself, which features to acquire. That's another area of research. They haven't received, I think active learning was hot, I think probably 20 years back, people were talking about it. I haven't seen much happening after that. This borrows some ideas from that. But the main thing is the focus of this has been on a live interaction in the contact center. How is it applied there? Those have mostly focused on, transmit. I mean, in those days, 20 years back, it was more about, I've got some data, which data do I need to transmit to a different place? Like, because there the data transmission costs in those days were high. So it focused on different types of problems.
Okay.
Excuse me.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. So my question is that a bigger portion of feature engineering is checking the data integrity. So how did you tackle the falsification of data in this particular use case?
Falsification by whom?
So the user, if you ask a user, do you use another credit card? He might as well say no when he uses a credit card, right? He might try to act over smart or try to read into the process. So how do you tackle those problems?
We didn't worry about it. I mean, there might have been some, could have been. I don't know. We didn't really think of worry about it. Yeah.
So do you think these are only corner cases, or the impact could have been larger than anticipated?
If there are a lot of customers falsifying, right? Then what will happen is your the utility of that question will go down. Right, if customers are falsifying, right, because it will basically cancel out. The people who are telling the truth and people who are falsifying, their effects will cancel out, and then the utility of the question will go down, and then the question will not become important. So yes, if a lot of people are falsifying, then this will not really work.
Is there a better solution around this problem, or is there a, if you can have a larger set of questions so that even if the utility of such questions goes down, some other questions substitute for this factor?
The way we looked at it is, why would a customer really, the kind of questions we asked, we carefully selected it so a customer wouldn't feel offended or wouldn't feel embarrassed or to answer it. So we didn't suspect really falsification, and it in fact our questions went through a regulatory process where the bank's regulatory team reviewed it, and it went through that process. So I don't think, we didn't suspect falsification really happening.
Right, thanks.
Hi, so can you give some more details about your pilot? So you said for two weeks there was pilot done. So is
it was a 6-week pilot. 2 weeks was kind of a warm-up phase, and then the real pilot was 6 weeks.
So what exactly happened in pilot? So is it like customers call and every customer was asked two random questions, or like?
Every customer is asked two questions, which are suggested by this tool.
But I thought with this pilot, you were learning and then...
No, that first two weeks was that phase when we were just collecting data based on, it was still through the tool, but it was based on business rules. Some business logic was used to select the questions.
I see. Yeah. And here your kind of dependent variable, what you're modeling, it becomes that did the customer took the product or not.
Yeah, the target variable is whether the customer took the product or not. Yes.
Yeah, there's a question here.
Yeah.
So you mentioned there is an update to the propensity model, right? So basically, you add some the propensity model score becomes some delta plus or negative, whatever, right? So is it memory less in the sense that the kind of question that you asked in the first versus the second, right? Mm. So the first one you ignore the memory, right? So and the second one impacts the end propensity score more than the first one, right? So by the question is basically, is it memoryless or stateless?
No, there is a state. Like the first propensity, after the first question, maybe the propensity went up by 0.5. Let's say 0.05. And then after the next question, again it went up by another point. Let's say it went up by minus 0.1. The second question had the impact. So the total impact would be 0.5 minus point plus 0.05 minus 0.1. So the net propensity would go down by minus 0.05.
So let's say if you were to extend this from 2 to say 10 mm-hmm. questions, right? So yeah. Then do you see a problem in terms of this aggregation things that we do?
Yeah, so then what would happen is sometimes if you know the propensities could go more than 1 or less than 0. In that case, we thought of that. What we would have to do is to actually put a sigmoid function. So the propensities go stay in that range.
So it's not linearly additive, right? It's basically a lattice where something go down, something go down, come down, or whatever is the relationship that you have, right?
Yeah.
So I'm not sure if this really works well for having more than two states or whatever.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
So
true. That's true. It will. If you have more than many questions, you'll have to modify this. You know, probably a multivariate rather than having a simple model like this with a univariate model. A multivariate model would make more sense.
And I think there's one comment on the active learning, right? So I think the Snorkel data programming, the way to generate the data to capture this propensity, right? I think it's still popular. I mean, a lot of active research is happening there. So.
Sure. All right, so I'll be around for some time. Thank you.